Vineyard, thank you for joining us. Please join us for worship. Sitting, standing.
Open the eyes of my heart. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
Worthy is the King who conquered.
you've done for me.
touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. God, you are here. You're turning lives around.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You know what independence is? That's independence. That's freedom. We have more to rejoice in than any firework that's going to get shot off this weekend. We're thankful we live in a country that we're free. We really don't even realize really what that means. Not until you've been in bondage in a civil way do you understand. But in a spiritual way, and what really, really matters, we are free, and we are free indeed. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And take a second. We have short announcements, but let's just bow our heads and let's just thank God for who He is, our way maker, our miracle worker. The Lord heard our prayers and our pleas last week, and He healed people. You know why? Because they asked. Because they asked. We just have to get past ourselves and past our pains and problems. Yeah, they're there. They're not going away. But even when I don't see you, you're working. Even when I don't feel you, you're working. So if you have a prayer need right now, I just pray that you would just raise your hand. There's got to be some in this. If you're not, you're not being honest with yourself. If you have a prayer need, raise your hand. We believe that God wants to take care of it for you. Lord, we just claim your throne as the righteous throne of all. You're the God of all creation. You're the God of all truth. You're the God of all purpose. You're the God of love, the God of peace. You're the God of purpose. Touch these people this day. Receive God's healing touch in Jesus' name. Stood on that cross for each one of us and carried all of our burdens and pains, all of our sins and problems, and said, it's finished. It's over. Let's just walk in God's power today. Let's just walk in God's power today. This is Independence Weekend, but we are free. We are free from ourselves. We are free from oppression. We're free from inflicted pains in our lives. We're free and free indeed. Well, thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you. That is who you are. 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 He prayed for his Holy Spirit to be here. Well, guess what? He is. Ask these things in Jesus' name, they'll be given unto you. We thank you, Lord God, for your presence. Nothing in this world can replicate that. And we're so thankful for that. Happy Independence Weekend to all of you. And again, be safe. Enjoy the weekend of festivities, because we really are blessed in a country that has many problems, but there's a whole lot more good than there is bad. And we're thankful for that. My name's John Cullen, and my wife Jill and I lead the prayer and prophetic here at the church. And I'm happy just to give you a brief announcement. If you're new here today, I'd rather be heard than seen. Anybody that comes see the band, you know that. But if you're a first-time guest, we love the fact that you found your way here today. This is a good family of people, and we're glad that you're here. But in the seat backs are connection cards, and that's how you communicate with us, and then we can get back with you and be there for you. But if you could drop one in the basket or drop one in out front, just let us know how you get there. We'd really appreciate that. For every card we receive, we're going to donate $10 to the Pontifex Food Outreach here, which serves not just Fremont, but a lot of Sandusky County. And we're so thankful that that ministry is in place. It means a lot to a lot of people. And so we're thankful to be the hands and feet to them and bless them. Also, there's a gift of some music and a welcome packet for you out there. I'd be happy to give that to you so you can take that home. If you join us from home today, there's a lot of you out there, and we'd like to get to know you in a better way. If you could, just go ahead and go on newhopevineyard.org/connect. Let us know how we can interact with you if you've got something that you need or something you'd like to comment about or just would like to connect in some way. We'd love to be able to do that, so if you would, please let us know. Be happy to do that. So right now, if the Vineyard kids could quietly just move on to their next phase of their time here today, we'd appreciate that. I always talk about how well-behaved they are, aren't they? You get kids out of their house, they just act nice. Right? Look how quiet they are. They're well-trained. Their parents are doing a really good job. Oh, we only have one really big announcement, and it's the table out in the gathering room. It's a lost and found. And all of us have been lost at one time, and all of us have been found. But that stuff out there is going away if you don't find it today. Today's the cutoff. If something out there belongs to you, please pick it up. If not, we'll donate it to somebody who can use it. All right? That's really about it. All right, so let's go ahead, if we could, pray for our tithes and offerings and get ready to bring Tony up to continue with the red letters after the mountain experience, and I'm expecting that to be very good today. But let's just thank God, Lord. We just praise you and worship you, and we cannot give you enough for what you do for us, not just for what you've done, but what you continually do. So I just pray that these tithes and offerings be used to bolster your ministry in an effective and meaningful way, that it supports our efforts here to continue to let others know how good you really are. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Awesome. All right. Cool. Nancy, would you mind going and putting the lights back up? Because I can't see anybody, and I feel like I'm alone up here. That's Jesus is with me. Absolutely. I'll receive that. Cool. Well, we are coming off an amazing week last week. If you weren't here, there was some really cool stuff going on where the Holy Spirit was just moving and people were being touched by the Holy Spirit. We received some healing last week, which was amazing. I never take that for granted, nor do I ever want to take that for granted. God does amazing things, and he should be praised and given all the glory for it because it's all about him. So very cool stuff. As John mentioned, we are in this Red Letters series where we're talking about the words that Jesus himself spoke. And we've spent the last couple months on the Sermon on the Mount from Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Jesus' longest recorded sermon, his longest recorded teaching while he was here on earth. And today, I want to kind of take a look at what happened right after that. What happened? Let's put this in context, because as we talk about quite a bit here at the church, context is everything, right? Reading the Bible, any historical document, we need to read in context and figure out what's happening then and before and after to see what's going on. And some amazing things happened right after Jesus came down from the mountain. Now, some of this is going to sound a little familiar because we talked about two of these cases earlier in the year with our words of healing and deliverance. But I think they need to be brought up again because I think they're very powerful stories, okay? Now, we do talk about context a lot, and it is so important. The Bible, in its entirety, is a story of God's love for humanity and his desire to have a relationship with us. The whole Bible, all 66 books, letters, epistles, history books, poetry, songs and psalms, the law. A lot of people go, well, yeah, but the Old Testament, that was for then. No, the Old Testament's the setup. That's the on-deck circle where Jesus is just getting ready to show up and do something amazing. And we need to understand from Genesis, the very beginning, all the way to Revelation, the very end, from the in the beginning to the last, amen, is the story of Jesus. And the Sermon on the Mount is the pinnacle, the apex of that precedes the meat of the story. For thousands of years, God's people were waiting and waiting and waiting and expecting, and boom, here comes Jesus. And then it just gets better from there. The Sermon on the Mount and what immediately follows, today's teaching, happens very early in Jesus' ministry. He had only had a handful, about six probably, of his 12 disciples at the time. And his reputation as a rabbi, a teacher, was just being established. The geographical location that he did this was ideal. Most theologians and scholars placed the Sermon on the Mount at a place called Mount Eremos. And right now it looks something like this, with a cathedral that had been built up there called the Church of the Beatitudes. And as you can tell, that's not something we would normally call a mountain in today's culture. It's kind of more of a hillside. But back then, it was called a mountain. It's along the northeastern shore of the Sea of Galilee in the Chorazim Plateau, in the region of Galilee. Galilee, we talk about Jesus was in Galilee. He's from Galilee. He walked along Galilee. It's not a city. It's an area. It's a region. Think maybe like a county, like Sandusky County versus Fremont, Ohio. All right? And here's the thing. Back then, why did he go up on a mountain? Well, it was very common to speak from a mountain or a hillside where the acoustics were perfect and sound carried for miles. So this is a view from the top of the hill. This is where he would go up and at a certain point stop, and people would gather along the hillside, and you would speak, and that sound would carry for miles. This was, believe it or not, before Bluetooth, so they needed this. The mountain that we're talking about here, where the Sermon on the Mount had taken place, Mount Eremos, is between Capernaum, which is Jesus' home base, and Gennesaret, which was the garden spot of ancient Israel, filled with farms and vineyards. But the point of the matter is that this was a geographical hot spot. It was a crossroads where people would go from larger cities like Capernaum down to Gennesaret and back and forth constantly. So there were hundreds of people coming across this road. And so when Jesus stood up there, granted, he probably had several people following him already up there. But what happens when you see a crowd? You got to join in, right? See what's going on, especially back then. This was before HBO. You had to have something to do. So you're walking along and you're going, what's that guy talking about? I don't know. Let's sit here for a little bit and figure it out. And more gathered. I'm sure there were times where people ran down off the hill back to their home and said, you got to come hear this guy. And hundreds, maybe even thousands of people gathered to hear this Jewish rabbi talking from on top of this hill. So we're going to dig in. We talked about what went on during that sermon, what he talked about over the last few weeks. And today we're going to talk about what happens when he comes down from that hill. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we open your word today, may we hear your word. May we hear your heart and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit that comes with it. May we open our heart to what you would say to us today. Come open-minded, open-hearted to receive. Father God, I pray that we would all put our predispositions, our presuppositions behind, our own agendas, and just listen to what you would say. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to be looking at Matthew 8, verses 1 through 17. If you're reading along, you can read along up on the screens. Or if you have a Bible, Matthew is your first book in the New Testament. Open it up, 8 chapters, and there you go. And it starts right here with, when Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Now, this would have been, people would have been freaking out because, first of all, you don't want to be around someone with leprosy. It's a pretty tight crowd, so you don't want him pushing through the crowd and touching you when he did. And the other thing is, it's against the law at the time for a person with leprosy to interact with other people. So this was scandalous, but this guy came and he knelt down before. And Jesus reached out and touched the man. He didn't put on gloves and wear a mask and get his hand sanitizer out. He touched the man and said, I am willing. Be clean. Be clean. There was something very important about that word there they used because it wasn't a matter of just physical healing. Again, this was against the law. It was not looked on as something good. In this culture, if you had leprosy, God cursed you because of something your family did. So he's not just saying, look, I'm going to heal you. I'm going to restore you, every bit of you, your body, your soul, your heart, and your mind. Be clean. And immediately, he was cleansed of leprosy. And Jesus said to him, see that you don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priests and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them. Okay, so let's look at a few things that we need to notice about this. The man didn't ask, hey, if you have a chance, will you help me? Hey, if it's not too much trouble, could you heal me today? The man said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. He called him Lord. He acknowledged Jesus' lordship as an act of humility. As he makes his statement of faith, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Remember, Jesus is just getting started here. He doesn't have this 3-year reputation that he had toward the end of his ministry. But there was something about him. There was this authority with which he spoke that we learned about in Matthew 7. But there was something, I think, about his presence that he brought with him where this man said, you know what, you can make me clean. Something's going on here. I listened to those words you preached, the way you taught, and I know you can make me clean. There's no sense of entitlement. He's not going, hey, I deserve this. I've been a pretty good guy. Just a statement of faith. And here's what I love. Jesus didn't spend hours or even several minutes praying over the man's situation. He just said, be clean. He didn't sit there and lay hands on him and go, oh, Lord, you know this man. And you know where he's been in life. And he's probably cursed because he's got the leprosy. And Lord, you know his family. And they're good people from over in that part of the Sea of Galilee because you know, Lord, where he lives over here. Right? We tend to do that when we pray for people sometimes. We kind of ramble on like we're trying to identify with them maybe. I don't know. He just said, be clean. See the difference? He took the authority that he had and he used it immediately to heal the man rather than preach at him or to pontificate about things he knew about the guy. And then he said, don't tell anyone. Go offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony. Jesus was telling the man to honor the law of Moses. Respect the traditions of the culture he was in. He was also going to serve as a witness to the religious leaders of the time. So he's saying, look, just go get healed. You're healed now. Now go do what you're supposed to do, what the law tells us we need to do, right? I always tell people, if you're healed here and people are like, oh, I'm healed, I'm going off my medication, don't do that. Go talk to your doctor first. And if anything, it'll be a wonderful testimony to him or her, to that doctor. Be clean. We'll continue with this chapter. So Jesus comes off the mountain, right? He's heading back to his home base, which is north along the, the sea in Capernaum. And when he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him and asked for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed, suffering terribly. Jesus said to him, shall I come heal him? And the centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. But just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. I tell this one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. He understands authority. Sorry, I forgot I had that up there. All right. When Jesus heard this, he was amazed. Wow. Wouldn't that be awesome to have someone say, man, when Jesus heard you say that, he was amazed. I would love for Jesus to be amazed at me. I think sometimes he's confused a little bit and going, yeah, I'm not sure about that guy. But what a wonderful thing to say about someone. Jesus was amazed. He says, truly I tell you, I've not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west, and they take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, let it be done just as you believed it would. And his servant was healed at that moment. Okay, some things to notice about this part of the passage. The centurion, an agent of Rome, right? Rome was Israel's oppressor, the occupying army at the time. And yet he comes humbly, saying, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That ultimate humility he shows. And responding to Jesus' inquiry of, shall I come and heal him? He responds with great faith. Just say the word. Just say the word and my servant will be healed. Think about this. This idea of remote healing. Jesus didn't even need to be in geographic proximity. He didn't have to touch. Doesn't happen that often in the Bible, and surely had not happened to that point, but the centurion's faith was so great, and Jesus' ability to heal his servant was so evident that it happened at that moment, at that very moment. Think about that. Think about this. Here's a centurion. The centurion, he's not a godly man. He's not been a good Jew for the last few years following Abraham and Isaac and the prophets. He's a Gentile. He's a soldier with the occupying force in the area. He's the guy you would least expect to get blessed by God. And yet, when Jesus spoke of him, he spoke of his great faith and lumped them in with people like Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. You see, it's not about the religious tradition. It's about what's in your heart. It's not about being a good Christian. It's about being a God follower in your heart. Wow. That's good stuff. Jesus was showing us again, it's not about religion. It's not about rites and practices. It's about humility and faith. It's about genuine belief and having that relationship with God then and today. This passage continues with Jesus then going from where he was to Peter's house. When Jesus came into Peter's house, he saw Peter's mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she got up and began to wait on them. This story, if you look at this, Jesus doesn't even say anything at this point. There's no red letters here, right? He simply touches her hand. And I love her response. She gets up and begins waiting on them. She feeds on them. She cares for them. She humbles herself as a servant. I love that. I love that. That's what my mom would have done. Get up, we're going to get you some food, right? You're in my house. Humble. Faith. The story concludes with a great crowd that gathers to be healed, some physically, some spiritually, with casting out of demons. When evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to him, to Jesus. He drove out the spirits with the word and healed the sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took up our infirmities and bore our disease. Can you imagine that? Here you are. You come down. You watch Jesus come down off the mountain. You follow him up the shore of the lake. And they get to this guy's house named Peter, who's one of his followers. Heals his mother-in-law, and people are just gathered outside this house. The streets are full, and he just goes out and just starts healing people. Boom, boom, boom. He delivers people from evil spirits. Boom, boom, boom. Wow. Wow. This had to be awesome. And it was awesome, not because people were good, faithful people that went to church every week and did this and did that and were nice people. It happened because they had the audacity to come and ask. To simply ask, like we talked about last week. It's not about saying the right things. It's not about doing the right rituals. Sometimes it's just about ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open. Just ask. Do we have enough faith to leave all of our agenda behind and just simply say, I need you, God? And that's what these people did. And in this point, Matthew was quoting Isaiah 53:4. He took up our infirmities, bore our diseases. And it's so important here in the context, so let me give you a little more context. Matthew, the guy who wrote this gospel, also known as Levi, one of Jesus' 12 disciples, was a well-educated Jewish man. His gospel is written primarily for Jewish people, the people of God, Israelites, who were faithfully waiting the Messiah. That's why his gospel starts with the entire lineage of Jesus, taking him through kings and prophets, all the way up to Joseph and Mary. His gospel has more references to Old Testament prophecies than any other gospel. And in this subtle reference to the prophet Isaiah, Matthew is telling the people, Jesus is the Messiah you've been waiting for. And here's the proof. Right here. Look at all the things he did. Hundreds of years before Jesus was even born, a man named Isaiah prophesied that that would happen. And it did. And it continued to happen for 3 more years after that. So what do we do with this? What do we do with this today? Because we can't go back to that mountain and see Jesus come down and follow him, at least literally. But what can we take away from it? Well, last week we talked about healing. We prayed for healing. We prayed about the simplicity of just asking. And the one thing that we really need to understand, the big point here, the big point is that only God can heal. It doesn't matter what the guy on TV tells you or what the traveling evangelist tells you or what some guy up here might even tell you. It's all God. It's all God. No human heals another person. We've got doctors who do a great job treating us and helping us with medicine, and I'm all about that. But it is God who heals. When we see a healing or any other miracle happen, it's not that person doing it. It's God doing it through that person. And we, thankfully, get to be conduits of the power. What do I mean by that? Well, think about a hose. Anybody have a garden hose, right? Take your garden hose out, try to water the flowers without turning the water on. It's just an empty tube. It's just a conduit for water to happen. It's only when it's hooked into the source and that source is released, that life comes out in the form of water to water your plants and that. It's the same way with God. Without being hooked into him, we can do a few things, but that hose runs dry pretty fast if we're not hooked into the source. We always acknowledge that it's God who does the healing, does the miracle, not us. Okay? I love when God uses me. If you've experienced that before, I guarantee you say that too. I love when God will utilize me, whether it's bringing healing or just speaking a word to somebody, praying over someone, and they go, wow, how did you even know that about me? you know it's God. I love when that happens. Because I myself am not worthy of that. I approach it humbly as much as I can. God is good. And once we understand this point that only God can heal and do these miracles and that, and fully embrace that it is God, it's all Him and it's all about Him, it does two things for us. One is it takes the pressure off us to pray the right prayer, to say the right thing. Remember, it's not about who you are or the words you say. The one guy just said, hey, can you heal me? It's about the attitude of our heart. And what the second thing it does is it puts the responsibility for the healing on God. But it also gives Him all the glory too, which is where that should be. So we humble ourselves. We ask with reverence. We command with authority. And then we watch God do His thing. Okay? Hear that again. We humble ourselves. We ask God with reverence. And we command with His authority. And then we watch Him do His thing. We need to get out of the way sometimes. We need to pray, believe, have faith, and then get out of the way and let the Holy Spirit do His work. I think too often we believe if we keep praying more and more and more, try to find the fancy church words to use, it's going to work better. Like somehow we can manipulate God into doing it better, twist His arm. I didn't say the right word. Did you ask with all your heart? Then you said the right word. It's not about using the fancy churchy words. Sometimes I think we keep talking and talking and praying and praying, and we think maybe we'll wear God down or somehow deserve the prayer more. If I keep praying more and more and more and just keep talking and talking and talking and talking, God's going to go, okay, just I'll heal him. Just go, please. But that's not the way God works. And we don't earn it by saying more words. And last week, again, we learned the most audacious thing we can do is just say, please, God, help me. I need just something very simple, believing that He wants to give us good things. That's the big thing. That's where our faith comes in. Do we believe He wants to give us good things? We need to get out of the way, humble ourselves, give Him the glory. Jesus shows us in this passage that few words said with great humility and faith can accomplish amazing supernatural things. But only when done through Christ's authority and the power of the Holy Spirit. Occasionally, it does take some persistence of praying, even fasting. But that's for the Holy Spirit to direct us, not for us to go, oh, I'll just keep praying and praying and praying. Is that what the Holy Spirit's calling us to? And remember, we can't earn someone's healing. That's for God to decide. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up as I just kind of finish up with the last couple things here. So earlier this year, as we started this series, I gave us three questions to think about. Really, just think about, and here they are again, and I'm going to give you a little bit of a response this time with them, an encouragement with each one. The first is, if we're not seeking God's will in every part of our life, why would we ever expect to be part of His kingdom? I know people are like, man, I feel like God's way out there. He's not even hearing me anymore. I can't even hear God. What's going on? When was the last time you opened your Bible? When was the last time you prayed? When was the last time you went to a Bible study with some people or a small group with some people and really dug deep? I don't have time for that. Well, how are we going to hear the voice of God? How are we going to get to know God if we don't interact with Him? Which leads us to the second thing. If we're not listening for God, Father's voice, why would we expect to hear from Him? Man, you tell me to pray and God will speak to me. I don't hear Him. Have you prayed? Have you opened up His word? Because if you want to hear the Father's voice, grab this thing. He speaks constantly through His word, the Holy Bible. And through other believers. Through prayer, through lots of things. The third question is, if we're not asking with a full assurance of faith in Jesus, why would we ever expect to receive? If we're not just going in with faith, if we go in going, you know, I'm going to ask, but I'm not sure if God really wants to get it. I don't want to bother God. I always love that. I do that sometimes. It's such a small thing. Why do I want to bother God for that? Why would we ever expect to receive? And here are the responses to give to this. The first is, let's begin to seek him in everything we do. If we want to be part of his kingdom, that's how we do it. We look for him in everything we do, not just Sundays, not just the time to have a little prayer. Jump in the car, let's pray while I'm going to work. While I'm at work, let me pray while I'm working. Maybe God will create some of those what we call divine appointments, where there's someone there who needs a life-giving word from you that day. We seek him in everything we do. Second, if we're not listening to the Father's voice, let's listen. Let's learn to hear the Father's voice. Okay? Let's listen and learn to hear the Father's voice. Then do what he tells us to do. Let's be obedient. Not just listen, but then do what he tells us to do. And the more we seek God, the more we listen for his voice, the more we learn what it sounds like. I'm going to give you a real quick story before I give this to them. So years ago, I was going through kind of a crisis of faith. And I'm praying, I'm just going, God, I need to hear from you. And I'm praying and I'm praying and I'm praying. I'm at the point where I'm in my house walking back and forth, pacing. This is where I'm still living in Cincinnati. And I felt like he said, just meet me up at Winton Woods. Great little park up by where we were. Nice walking trails and that. So I went up there, and I felt like when I pulled in, I felt like the Lord said, just come and listen. I'm like, rock on. I'm willing to listen. Here come the answers, right? So I park, I get out, I take a walk through the woods. Sit down on a little bench in the middle of nowhere. Can I hear the wind going through the trees, maybe some little critters through the leaves on the ground. Got so quiet at one point, I could hear my own heartbeat. And I'm listening. And I start praying, and I hear God correct me and say, no, just listen. And I'm like, okay, this is going to be a great revelation, if you know, right? For an hour and a half, I'm sitting there in the middle of the woods, listening for this great revelation that never came. Oh, yeah, you're right. That was not my response. I wish that had been my response. My response was, what the heck, God? I could have been doing things. You called me out here for an hour and a half. I walked back to my car, angry, stomping my feet like a petulant child. Get in my car, and I go, what was that about, God? I did. And I heard this still small voice say, I called you here just to learn to listen. Never said he was going to tell me anything. He was just teaching me to listen. Silence is one of the greatest spiritual disciplines. To just sit in silence, especially in today's society. Oh, man, right? But to turn everything off, find a quiet place, and just sit in silence and listen. And God will respond. Sometimes he answers us directly. Other times he just teaches us. Listen. Final thing, if we're not asking, ask. Let's ask. Being so audacious in our faith that simply asking is enough. No rituals, no special words, no working for it, just asking and believing that God wants to give us the desires of our hearts. I'll repeat what I said before. Few words said with great humility and faith can accomplish amazing supernatural things. So I'm going to finish with a question today. What are you asking for today? what are you asking for today? And most of us, if I'm not a mind reader, but if I had to guess, most of us would go, oh, I'm cool, thanks. I don't need prayer, I'm good, right? I've been blessed. What more do I need to ask for? I don't know. What do you need to ask for? He wants to give. What do you need today from the Lord? Are you willing just to simply ask and believe? Because he wants to give to you today. And so my encouragement would be, now we have people up who will be up here who will pray with you. But if you came asking today, I would say come asking, come expecting to receive. What you need might be not what you wanted, but always what you need. If you need prayer, they'll be up here. But before you come meet with them to be prayed over and prayed with, have your own altar right where you are. And have that vertical conversation, you and God only. Go, God, I am coming today, and I need fill in the blank. And take it a step further than the guy with leprosy who said, if you want to, you can heal me. Today we're going to say, if you want to, you will heal me. You will answer my prayer, right? So we're going to worship. Have your time with God right where you are. And then if you feel you need more prayer, you come up and meet with the people on the sides of the church, all right? All right. Father, thank you. Thank you. You love us so much that you say, just ask and receive, that your joy would be made full. Make yourself real to us today. Where we've gotten lazy and comfortable, kind of make us a little uncomfortable to move us back to where we need to be. Convict our heart. And Lord, where we are broken and hurting, comfort us. Bring healing today. There are people here today, Lord, who've come who are asking with good, faithful hearts, wanting to receive. These are your children. We know that you give good things to your children. So I say to you right now, if you're here today and you're asking, receive. Be encouraged and receive. Receive that what you've asked for. And then we're just going to praise him as we sing one more song together. In Jesus' name.
God, I just pray for the person who needs hope. That you would restore the heart that's broken today, whoever that may be. You give life. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore. Heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life. Come, Lord. You give life. You got love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. Restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord.
So we pour out our praise to you, Holy.
Yes, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Right? We serve a great God, right? All right. Guys, have an amazing week. Be safe tomorrow if you got stuff going on and today. But have a great Independence Day. Remember, it's Christ who set you free. Love you guys. Have a good day. Bye. Thank you, Lord.